hope that they turn. Okay. Stone carved marking in Malta has a long, long history going back at least to the Bronze Age there. But recently, more unofficial carvings have been used to demarcate space ownership and identity by a myriad of groups. Today, I'm going to focus on the graffiti produced by British officers and troops stationed in Malta during the 19th century. But first, I want to look at some of the military markings made by the Knights of St. John, who were there before the British, the reason being that they were also military men, and it's a nice comparison of a different military community. Also, the stone carved markings that were made by the knights, such as this, were visible to the British officers and troops living in the same barrack and officers' quarters while they were there. Okay, so the first set of graffiti is from Fort St. Elmo in Valletta. The clear names marked above doorways often give examples of who was living in the actual quarters. These are the quarters of the knights, so these are the top knights, these are the good quarters. And the fact that they were actually claiming space and ownership of their rooms is very clear in this example. Example was just gone, which somebody's actually written, Chambre la Guiche, actually claiming that as his own. Interestingly, some of these names do appear in various places around the site. The first slide I showed you was Rebus, and he was actually the priest of the chapel on the site, and his name appears on all kinds of walls and lintels, and it's very unclear whether he was marking his name or someone else was. Okay, Roman Catholic iconography is present around the site, such as the IHS sign there, and as well as the shields demarcating the line of the knights to which they belonged. Both referencing core institutions that structured their lives and played a large role in self-definition and the fashioning of their identities. There is lots of British graffiti in Fort St. Elmo, but most of it's in Lower Fort St. Elmo, and I can't access there at the moment because it's full of squatters. this is a nice example of a rare piece of British graffiti that has been found on Upper Fort St. Elmo of the Victoria Regina monogram. Strangely, even though the officers were occupying the same barracks as the knights, British officers were occupying the same barracks as the knights in the early part of the 19th century, there is very little British material in Upper Fort St. Elmo. Okay, moving on, this is now a site that is called the Inquisitor's Palace, but during the 19th century, it was a British officer's mess. I'd like to move on to this. The mess started in 1835, but the graffiti has led me to believe that in the early 1800s, troops and officers were barracked there together. The most of the graffiti appears in the ex-prison cells of the Inquisitors. I've just given you an example there of some of the graffiti that was already on the walls, which would have been visible to the troops arriving in the early 1800s. All of the British period carving appears on the ground floor around the old prison complex. So interestingly, they don't seem to have graffitied anywhere else where they were actually living. In the prison complex, you have many names of British troops and officers that were linked there. But interestingly, one of the things that you find is that it's actually quite a small range of names. So you have people marking their name several times. One of the things that I've been interested in looking at this is specifically John Slack, who presents his name often in conjunction with Staffordshire and Wolverhampton, which is presumably where he's from, because in the early 1800s the regiments were not given the name of Staffordshire at that time. And the regiment of the 39th is repeated many, many, many times, and they were there before 1810. So I've got some clear evidence now, using this as a historical document, of what was going on in the building during those very early years of the 1800s, for which there are no surviving historical records. Here you have an example of John Slack, and you can see at the top there he's actually written the S backwards on his name. One of the ideas of the repeated marking of this I have is that perhaps we're actually seeing some people practicing writing their name and practicing writing the few words that they actually know. So we could be looking at partially literate people. Backward letters in names is quite common in the late 18th and early 19th century for people that have learned how to write their name but aren't necessarily literate. Okay, so the soldiers here are marking, this is a good example, this is a much later example from 1873. I've left it upside down because this has actually been reused and taken upstairs in 1930s reconstruction of the site. So it shows that it has been kept in some way, but obviously not very carefully because it's upside down. The British graffiti really differs from what the knights were doing. It was clear demarcation of rooms and place most of the time in the knights' barracks, but the placing of the British graffiti within what was existing cell complexes does leave me to think that they were actually being reused and actually incarcerated. So we could actually be looking at undocumented incarceration there. Okay, this is an example of where I believe that prison, the Inquisition prison graffiti, has been added to, and I shall now just like to end with the fact that I've included both kinds of graffiti because they're both military communities, but it really draws out the different kind of marking you get from a community that's actually living in the place to a very mobile community like the British Army was. So to leave you with a curse, which had just gone off, the curse read, I'm not sure I can go backwards one now, the curse read, Goddamn old Stuart, and sent his two eyes may drop out his head, May 7th, 1805.